Good afternoon and welcome to the latest instalment in BioExcel's webinar series. My name is Adam Carter, I'm from the BioExcel project, today we're very happy to welcome Simone Meloni, who's going to be talking about multiple timescales in atomic simulations. So I'm just going to give you a very quick introduction now, no more than 5 minutes, a little introduction to BioExcel, what we do for those of you who are less familiar, and then I will hand over to Simone for the rest of the talk today. So for those of you who don't know about BioExcel, we are a center of excellence for computational biomolecular research, and there are sort of three main pillars to the work that we're doing at the moment. The first is a biomolecular software. So one of the things that we're trying to do is to improve the performance, efficiency, and scalability of certain key codes that are widely used in the biomolecular research community. So in the project at the moment, we have some of the lead developers from Gromax and Haddock and people working on the QMMM interface in CPMD. So these codes are important to what we do, but we're also interested in other codes as well. Another important part of what the project is looking at is usability. So usability of these codes and how they can be used as part of wider biomolecular research workflows. So we've got work going on in the project to make it easier to integrate these codes and other ones into workflow environments, including the ones that I've got shown here. And the final part of what we're trying to do is to promote best practices and to train end users in aspects related to these codes and to the usability aspects to the workflow platforms as well. The consultancy and training, that's one of the aspects that I'm involved in, and as part of the consultancy we also have interest groups which are open for anyone to join. So if you're interested in any of these things, I think that possibly the hybrid methods might be of interest to some of the audience for this webinar, but you can see there's a number of different interest groups here that you can join to keep in touch with what we are doing in all of these different areas. One little pointer, it's a rather last minute now, but the registration is still open. If you can join us in Amsterdam next week, we are holding our first community forum event that will be based at the Lloyd Hotel and Cultural Embassy. This is a networking event with a program of interactive working groups aligned with the BioExcel interest groups that I've just mentioned on the previous slide. It's free, so if you are interested in finding out more or registering, you can go to this URL here. All right, so Simone has indicated that he is happy to take a question as he goes along in the talk today, but it probably is easiest if you save up most of your questions until the end of the talk. We'll make sure there's plenty of time at the end for you to ask questions. The easiest way for you to do that is to type your question into the question box at the side of your screen in GoToWebinar. It'll look similar, not identical, but similar to this control panel that you see here. So if you click where it says questions, then you can type your question. Then at the end, if you have a microphone and you want to ask your question directly, I'll open your mic and you can address Simone directly. Otherwise, I'll read out your question and Simone can answer it then. If you're watching this webinar as a recording on YouTube, and you've got some questions for us later on, you can ask those at BioExcel's forum. That's ask.bioexcel.eu, and we'll make sure that somebody passes that question on to Simone or answers it directly there. So I'd like to now introduce today's presenter. Dr. Simone Meloni is a research professor at the Department of Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering at the University of Roma La Sapienza. He works on applications of computational statistical mechanics to fundamental and technological problems, especially related to energy technologies, materials for third generation solar cells, energy storage, energy scavenging, and so on. He's developed techniques for the simulation of rare events, that is, events which are too infrequent to be observed on the timescale that's accessible to brute force simulations. And he's also developed non-equilibrium techniques, which in principle allow you to exactly compute statistical quantities in atomistic and molecular systems out of equilibrium. So I'm now going to hand over to Dr. Simone Meloni. So Simone, I will make you the presenter and I will let you take it from here.
Hi Adam. Hi everybody. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for organizing this webinar and giving me the chance to present part of our work, part of the work I've done with some collaborators, and a topic which I found quite interesting in general. As Adam said, of course, I'm ready to take questions during the seminar, especially if addressing this question will help keep following what I'm telling, so feel free to ask them. Or if you prefer, you can ask at the end and we'll try to be as exhaustive as possible. So what Adam was saying before about the objectives of BioXcel somehow is a nice combination with what I'm going to tell right now. So one of the points Adam made before is that one of the objectives of BioXcel is to improve efficiencies of the code, which of course is a key issue. Still, you have to keep in mind that some of the problem we want to address in chemistry, physics, biochemistry, and so on, they exceed the time scale which is affordable by present and possibly future generations of supercomputers. And for this, we need some special techniques, which is a subject of my seminar of today. So let me give you, first of all, a short outline of the seminar. I will start trying to convince you that you might need special techniques for dealing with this kind of problem. I will first give you an example of a simple but well-known rare event problem in molecular simulations. Then I will try to convince you that there are cases in which the standard techniques, they are not enough, and I will present you a couple of different techniques to address the problem of a reconstruction of free energy or study of rare events in high-dimensional space. And I will conclude show you a couple of illustrations of the use of these techniques. So let me start from the problem for the apparent toy problem, which is the one of isomerization of an alanine dipeptide. So isomerization is essentially the change of conformation from the, roughly speaking, linear one into this this curved one. So essentially, this can be described as a rotation around one or few dihedral angles of these molecules. And so if you are interested just in this problem, you can coarse grain the description of the process, passing from the descriptions in terms of the positions of all the atoms, so three times the number of atoms composing the alanine dipeptide, into the description description in terms of one, two, or few dihedral angles, which make you more focused on the problem you really want to address. And the typical question you ask about this, they are the statistics of the transition. So what is the probability that the system goes from one, what is the probability that the transition, that the system stays in configuration one or configuration two, how much time it takes for going from configuration one and configuration two, and what is the path, what is the most likely trajectory to go from configuration one to configuration two. So this is the kind of question I would like to address. And so let me introduce a couple of observables which typically we use to describe this process. So if we decided to describe the process in terms of a set of collective variables, these observables which can better describe the process, the dihedral angles in the example I was showing before, one of the natural questions to ask is what is the probability to observe a given value of this dihedral angle. So for example, the probability to observe the value 180 degrees of this dihedral angle and measure what is the stability of the state with respect to the stability of the state in which the dihedral angle is no longer 180 but is zero. So already just this example tells you how much important can be the probability. But of course, the probability is also important all along the process because it tells you what are the configurations which are the most likely visited along the isomerization process, and so implicitly the reactive part. Then, of course, the probability it changes quite rapidly when you change configuration. So very often we are used to this, to use instead of the probability, it's logarithm. And when you express the logarithm of a probability in a thermal unit, so kbt, where kb is the Boltzmann constant, you end up into what is usually called the Landau free energy. So the Landau free energy is a kind of free energy in which the relevant observable describing your system, on top of temperature and so on, is the set of collective variables describing your system in the coarse grain descriptions. So once again, in this case, it will be the free energy of the collective variables. So why is this free energy important? Well, for example, it's crucial to estimate the times or the time tau or the rate that of the isomerization process. So this can be described via an Arrhenius-like or a transition state theory equation in which you have a pre-exponential factor, tau infinite, and an exponential term which depends on the barrier, so the difference of free energy in between the initial minimum of the free energy and the top of the free energy before you end up in the other system, divided by the free energy, the thermal energy available to the system. So once you know in principle the free energy landscape of the system, you're also able to estimate the kinetic of the relevant transition in the system using equation like this, which requires once again to identify the extremal point of your free energy landscape, so minima and transition state. So one in principle can imagine to use brute force molecular dynamics to compute this free energy, because one can run just a very long trajectory. One can construct the histogram of the trajectory, so compute how many times your system, your trajectory visit a discretization of the coarse graining of your system, so a discretization of the collective variable space. This is an estimate of the probability. One can normalize this probability and take the logarithm, and the logarithm will be the estimate of the free energy. And when you have the free energy, as I told you before, you can also, in principle, compute the rate of the process. The point is that when you are in presence of barriers much higher than the thermal energy, typically this means that the time your system takes to visit the other minima of the free energy starting from the initial one, it scales exponentially with the barrier. So typically this time is very long, is much longer than the characteristic times of your system. So for example, the characteristic time of a normal system is connected to the vibrational spectrum of the system, femtoseconds or so, while the relevant process, alanine dipeptide isomerization, can be even in the range of microseconds, seconds, or if the molecule is a macromolecule, even longer. So this brute force approach doesn't work, because for how efficient you can, if efficient can be your molecular dynamics code, typically the time it is needed to run such a long molecular dynamics exceed the capability of your supercomputer. So this means that typically you need to use some acceleration techniques. And actually there is an array of acceleration techniques one might want to use. So for example, one can use umbrella sampling, constrained molecular dynamics that you may call Blue Moon Ensemble. You can use metadynamics, boxed molecular dynamics, forward flux samplings, and many others. So one problem with, or if you wish, one characteristics of these techniques is that typically they are able to target a limited number of collective variables, one, two, or few of them. And sometimes this is insufficient. Let me give you an example in which this is not sufficient. And once again, let me resort to the alanine dipeptide problem. So here is illustrated the striped configuration. And here there are a couple of wrapped configuration of the alanine dipeptide. And the question is, what is the trajectory and what is the barrier to go from this one to one of these two? And we consider the case in which we coarse grain the process in terms of two angles, only two dihedral angles, phi epsi, or with four dihedral angles, adding to the first two also theta and z. if you compute the ideal path to go from one state, the initial one, to the final one, with two and four collective variables, actually you obtain two different free energy profiles, which differ both in terms of the barrier for the solarization process and also in terms of the shape, which seems to suggest a different mechanism of the process. Now you may wonder which of the two descriptions is the good one, the one with two collective variables or the one with four collective variables. And actually there is a way in which you can address this question rather precisely, which is by investigating the committer function at the putative transition state of your process. What is the committer function? The committer function is the probability that starting from a given configuration in your system ends up in the product before than the reactant. So for example, if you are sitting in one configuration here and you shot a number of trajectories, you might end up with a given probability in the product here, say along the green trajectory, and with a different number, with a complementary probability in the reactant. Now you expect that if you are on the transition state, the committer function is 50%. So you have same probability to go into the product rather than into the reactant. and so if you have an ensemble of configurations belonging to the transition state, so for example, you compute a constant temperature molecular dynamics under the constraint or restraint that your system stay at the top of your free energy profile, you get the gray in the case of four collective variables and black in the case of two collective variables ensemble. And from each of these configurations, you can shot a set of trajectories. So for each configuration, you can compute the committer function. And what you expect is that if your transition state is a good one, the committer function of all these configurations is peaked around 0.5 probability, so 50%. While if your collective variable set is not good, they are distributed, for example, in a uniform way. In any case, not peaked around 0.5. So what we observe is that actually, even for such a simple system, which has been investigated plenty of times, two collective variables gives a committer function distribution which is quite uniform, which is, as I just told you before, and we will see in a second a bit more in detail, is an indication of an insufficient set of collective variables. While with four collective variables, the distribution of the committer function is well peaked around 0.5, which is an indication that now you have a set of collective variables which is sufficient to address the problem you want to investigate. Now let me show you why the collective variable or corrective variables you pick can be insufficient. Actually, we can split the problem in a taxonomy of four cases. And let me illustrate you these four cases for a simplified scenario in which actually you have 2 degrees of freedom and you decide to use one for coarse graining the process. So each of these panels represent one of these cases. Each panel is composed of three figures. The first figure, the main one, is the energy landscape described by isocontour line in the two-dimensional space. And here, typically, you have two attractive basins, A and B, say that A is the reactant and B is the product. And the dashed line represents the putative transition state computed with the only variable you consider to be you consider for the constraint, Q in our example. And so Q star represents the position of the transition state in the coarse graining, so in the Q variable. The top panel is the projection of the energy function along this dashed line. So is the projection of the energy along the remaining degrees of freedom, S, when the one used for the constraint is constrained to be on the transition state. And the bottom panel is the corresponding distribution of the committer function. So let's consider the first case. In the first case, you have that the attractive region of the basin A is on the left of the putative transition state. The attractive basin of the product B is on the right of the transition state. You have a minimum of the energy along the putative transition state, which is in correspondence of the transition state, which I remember you is the saddle point, so it's expected to be a minimum along n minus 1 directions. And if you shot a set of trajectories from configurations belonging to the transition state, you would expect that 50% of the time they will end up in B, 50% of the time they will end up in A. So in principle, you expect them to be a delta function centered around the 0.5 value. But usually, because you have errors or things of that kind, you expect something which is a broad distribution but peaked around 0.5 case. Now let us move to the example two here, same column, lower line. So in this case, you don't have attractive basin of A in the left and of B in the right, but actually the attractive basin, they overlap if you describe them only in terms of one collective variable Q. So for example, if you sit in this place, you will expect that most of the time a trajectory shot from here will end up in A. If you sit in this place here, most of the time you'll end up in B. And so, here in between them, instead of a saddle point, you have a maximum along S direction. And so most of the time your system, if it is constrained to be in the transition state, won't stay in the center, but will stay in the region of attraction A and region of attraction B. So the commutator distribution in this case typically is peaked at zero, which is when trajectories start from this region, and so they have essentially zero probability to end up in B, and one, which correspond to trajectory shot from this region, which have 100% probability to end up in B. So you see that if you use just one single collective variable to describe the transition state in this case, or the entire process in this case, this is highly insufficient. Actually, you can guess just by intuition that a good representation of the process requires that the transition state is a diagonal line here, cutting the two basins in two. But of course, this is not the only possibility we can imagine. There's a third one, the one in which the two basins, two attractive basins, are still in the left and right of the putative transition state, but you have a wide flat region in between. So in this case, if you shot from this region, you will end up in A. If you shot from this region, you will end up in B. But if you shot from the beginning, from the center, you have essentially 50-50% probability to end up in A and B. And so in this case, you will have a distribution of the commutator which is rather uniform, like this, which actually is a situation similar to the one of two collective variables we consider for the alanine dipeptide. So this means that the alanine dipeptide with just phi and psi dihedral angle for the coarse graining of the process belongs to this scenario. Finally, you have a fourth scenario, the one like this, in which your putative transition state is completely based in one of the basins, so like something like this, that the real trajectory you expect to pass along this line, but indeed, if you consider just one collective variable, you put a different transition state, so your maximum of the energy is like this. And in this case, you will have that the commutator function is picked only in, should be in one. Here, I think there is an error, instead is reported picked in zero, instead should be picked in one. So you see that you can have a completely wrong representation of your process if you use an insufficient or inadequate set of collective variables for describing it. So the question I want to address today is when typically you need a significant number of collective variables, your process is so complex that you cannot easily guess a limited number of them, like in this case, just four dihedral angles, but the one in which perhaps you need to go beyond this limit, many of them, which typically cannot be addressed with standard techniques. And I will present you two techniques to address this problem. One is the single sweep method in its improved version, and the second is the string method. So the objective of the single sweep method is to reconstruct a free energy landscape in a large dimensional space. So when you have many collective variables, say 5, 6, 7, or 8, something of that order. Standard techniques, what they do usually is that they reconstruct the free energy landscape while the system explore the space. So for example, this is the case of metadynamics. So you drop Gaussians, so you introduce an history-dependent potential, which make it less likely to visit regions which are already visited. And the Gaussian that you drop themselves, they allow you to reconstruct the free energy landscape at the end of the simulation. So the single sweep approach is different. You introduce an acceleration dynamics just to identify the regions of the space which are important because they contain metastable states, so minimum of the free energy, and the regions which allow to connect one metastable state to the other. And then you reconstruct the free energy landscape in this subdomain of the entire space in a second step. So let me first speak of the first step. So to explore the first step, one can use plenty of different techniques, including metadynamics, which I just mentioned. We use what is called temporal accelerated molecular dynamics. So you extend the standard molecular dynamics over the atoms with an additional molecular dynamics which allow to change the value of the collective variables. Let me explain in detail each of these two dynamical equations. So this is, if you just consider the first part of this dynamical equation plus this term, which is the thermostat I attach to run constant temperature molecular dynamics, this is standard molecular dynamics. What we do here in addition is that we add a harmonic-like term which force our system to visit configurations which are consistent with the present value of the collective variable. So you see that as soon as the present value of the collective variables differs from the target value, you have an harmonic force which forces our system to get in a configuration which is closer to the one compatible with the present value. So essentially, this system is driven by two forces, one which is the physical force, another one which is a restraining force which limit the region it can explore, limit in forcing the system to visit configurations which are only close to the present value of the collective variable. Then we have a complementary equation for the current value of the collective variable itself, for the Z, which is different from the value you will compute from your present configuration. And once again, you can imagine that the dynamics of the system is driven by the same potential. Of course, the first term, the physical potential, which doesn't depend on Z, doesn't add any force on the dynamics of the collective variable. Only the second one will add a term. Now, in this dynamics, we have two tunable parameters. One, which is the mass of the value of the inertia of the collective variable, and one which is the temperature of the two thermostats. And I will avoid to describe in details because this running properly these dynamics requires some understanding of the dynamics of the system and some tuning. So in general, what we do is that we set the mass of the collective variables large enough that the characteristic times of the collective variables is much slower than the characteristic times of the atoms. And we set the temperature such that the thermal energy available to the collective variables is much higher than the thermal energy available to the atoms. And I will show you why this in a minute. So first of all, with this choice of the masses, the collective variables, they essentially move in the field of the average force, of the average configuration of the atoms. So essentially, it is like if they are driven by an average force. And this average force is the mean force in the approximation of a perfect separation of time scales in between atoms and collective variables. So it is like if the collective variables, they move over the free energy landscape. And if the temperature is large enough, the collective variables can easily overcome the barriers which are possibly present over the free energy landscape. So in principle, you can set the temperature such that your system is able to overcome barrier such that barrier of the 8, which is compatible with the thermal energy deriving from the non-physical T prime, not the physical T. So in other words, you are accelerating the exploration of the free energy of the system computed at the physical temperature by having this altered temperature only on the collective variables. So once again, I am exploring the physical free energy at the physical temperature, but in an accelerated fashion. So for example, by doing this on the toy problem of the Muller potential, with the time affordable by standard molecular dynamics, I can explore the regions which are about the minima. Say, starting from the deepest minimum, I'm still able to explore the metastable minima. And also the region which allows me to go from one state, the absolute minimum, to the other state. So also the putative transition state. The following problem is to be able to reconstruct the free energy. Now, the idea here is that the free energy is nothing else than a function. And so, in principle, I can expand this function on a suitable basis set. So what we do here is that we expand the free energy function over a Gaussian basis set. And in order to be able to reconstruct this free energy function, then I have to determine the coefficient of the expansion. And since we decide the basis set, the Gaussian in this case, to have possibly a variable width, which better suit the shape of the free energy landscape, also the value of the width of the Gaussians. And we can also make the Gaussians anisotropic, so have different width along different direction in the collective variable space. So we have to find a way to obtain this CK and sigma K. So one way in which you can imagine to do it is to minimize an objective function, suitable one, with respect to C and sigma. So what is the objective function that we introduce? Is the difference between the minus gradient of the free energy defined by this expansion and the mean force that we can obtain with any of the many standard techniques. So you can compute the mean force in simulation by constrained molecular dynamics, by restrained molecular dynamics, and many other ways. in particular, this objective function can have a non-trivial weight. And what we do often is that we use a weight such that points at very high mean force, they are less important in the definition of the objective function. So you see that our weight is something which is of the type 1 or over f to the square. Then, of course, we had to add a little value to this f because in proximity of the minima, f can go to 0. So this definition of the objective function can become unstable. And the way in which you avoid this problem is to add a little delta here. At this point, is just the point is just to find an approach to minimize this objective function E of C and sigma and do it over the relevant range of the all possible values of the collective variables, which has been identified before along the accelerated molecular dynamics. So for example, what we do is that along our molecular dynamics, we identify points. Here we don't drop any Gaussians, nothing like that. So we just drop points which are distributed over the interesting regions and say, for example, they are at a constant distance in between them, which means that we have a good and uniform description of the free energy landscape. And then this defines the position of the Gaussian function I introduced before, this ZK. And then we are left with minimizing this objective function. So minimization of objective function can be made in many different ways. The way in which we do it is by simulated annealing. So this means that you start from trial value of C and sigma, and you give them give to this value a random displacement. So from initial C prime and sigma prime, you obtain C second and sigma second. And then you can accept or reject this move by a standard Metropolis criterion, in which you introduce an epsilon, which is a measure of the probability that a move up in energy is accepted. And slowly by slowly, you reduce the epsilon such that at the end of this iterative procedure, you will end up in certainly one metastable minimum of this parameter space landscape. Once you have C sigma, C and sigma, the optimal one, you can reconstruct the free energy landscape just by the linear combination of the Gaussian functions. And here, I am presenting you three cases of a potential energy that has been used to try to reconstruct the Müller potential. So this is just a test case to see how the approach works. So the one you see here in the top panel is the vanilla approach. So essentially, it's the one in which you have expansion on a Gaussian basis set, and for all points, you use the same sigma, and you weight all points in the same way without this this special weight I introduced here, without this special weight. So in the case in which mu I is equal 1 for all the points in our summation. So already at this level, you have a qualitative good reconstruction of the potential surface. You identify here black is the exact one, red is the reconstructed one, and you see that already at this level, red presents metastable states in proximity of the real metastable states, transition state, which is close to the real transition state. Still, you see plenty of features which are quite different. So as long as you're interested in a qualitative description of the process, already the Vanilla approach is okay. However, since in this case, you see that there are strong asymmetry in the potential, it is probable that using a single value of the width of the Gaussian, which is the same for all the Gaussians, and it is isotropic, will be inefficient. So what we do is that we replace a single Gaussian into a Gaussian containing a covariance matrix. So here, sigma k actually is an n by n matrix. And we allow to the all the diagonal and off-diagonal terms, apart for symmetry reason, in principle to be different, and we optimize each of them. And you see that already when you introduce asymmetry in the directionality of the Gaussians, you have a very nice reconstruction of the energy landscape. But still, since you are giving the same weight to regions of relatively low and relatively high energy, you have that sometimes the reconstruction is not accurate, like in this region. So if on top of this you add the weighting factor not uniform, that I mentioned before, actually you obtain a very accurate reconstruction of the free energy all over the landscape of interest. Now, let me show you single sweep at works in a real case. Here we were interested in a material for hydrogen storage, alanates in particular, and we were interested in processes involving the hydrogen transfer, actually H minus transfer, in these complex materials that in principle can involve plenty of degrees of freedom. And we wanted to reconstruct the free energy landscape using as collective variables the coordination number of aluminum, which are these green spheres, with respect to hydrogen, which are these white spheres around. So we selected two collective variables, which are the number of hydrogen around two aluminum atoms, which were exchanging one proton, and reconstructed the free energy landscape in this two-dimensional space. And we wanted to compute how goes the accuracy with an increasing with increasing size of the basis set. So you see that already considering just 25 Gaussians over this region, we have a maximum error here, which is of the order of 0.01 electron volt. Since these calculations, they were done with DFT, density functional theory, essentially this error is at the limit of the accuracy of DFT. So going beyond this limit was essentially useless. So this shows that already just a calculation of 25 mean forces, which is needed to conclude the reconstruction with 25 Gaussian element basis set, will be sufficient to have a very accurate reconstruction of the free energy. We didn't do the comparison with other techniques because it was not the objective of the papers, but essentially because this costed us order of 80 picoseconds of molecular dynamics simulation, which is a significant time, but probably other techniques in which you need to have a regular taxation of the space, which is scaled exponentially with a number of collective variables, would have been much more expensive. Also, the same approach has been applied in the field of biochemistry, and here what people were interested, I was not part of this article, is the diffusion path of carbon oxide out of myoglobin. Myoglobin is at the same time relatively simple, relatively complex protein, which in principle can absorb oxygen and carbon dioxide, and it has four metastable states which are known experimentally, which are located in the structure. And by reconstructing the free energy landscape with respect to the position of carbon oxide, of the center of mass of carbon oxide using single sweep method, people were able to identify the metastable states, so the minima, local minima of the free energy in myoglobin, and actually they have a very nice matching with the experimental position which have been identified by Xenon. And now knowing the position of these metastable states and the free energy over the entire landscape, the entire space, one can also reconstruct diffusion paths, so the paths connecting the metastable states which have been identified. And also these paths which people have found, they coincide quite well with some huge effort which has been done with brute force simulations or other simulation techniques. So even though one can go beyond a three-dimensional free energy landscape, within what is doable with other systems, this approach seems to be quite well in agreement with known results, experimental and computational. However, often one has to go beyond this significant but limited number of collective variables. I told you that the number of dimensionality in which you can use a single sweep is typically 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, that order of magnitude. But sometimes you need tens, hundreds, thousands, or even more collective variables. I will give you an example shortly. So in this case, one has to give up to reconstruct the entire free energy space. It's way too complex. And one should be happy with reconstructing just the most probable path to go beyond known reactant and products. I won't develop the entire theory here, but one can prove that within the coarse grain representation, so within a collective variable space, this most probable path obey this equation here. Let me tell you what this equation means. So essentially, it means that the force orthogonal to the path is equal to zero. Now, apart a matrix, which I will explain in a minute. Now, this is actually, if you think for a moment, quite intuitive. So imagine yourself to walk from a valley to another valley along a mountain path. What you will do, you will stay in the lowest possible place at the level of progress along your path. And this is what this equation is telling you. So while I progress, I will sit myself in the lowest possible place, so where the force is equal to zero, when the energy is minimum, along that level of progress. So not the absolute minimum of the energy, but the minimum of the energy along that level of progress. It's exactly like walking along a mountain path. Now, since we are passing from a coordinate representation into a coarse grain representation, a collective variable representation, perhaps we are doing a non-canonical transformation, and certainly we are doing a reduction of the space. This matrix in front, this metric matrix in front, is exactly the result of this fact. The result that we are perhaps rotating and reducing the dimensionality of the space. And actually, it depends on the derivative, on the gradient of the collective variables with respect to the coordinates. But this is a minimum technical problem. Now, taking once again as an initial example the Müller problem, what we want to compute in principle is the optimal path to go from the absolute local minimum here to the absolute minimum here. And what one can imagine to have is just a first guess of this path. For example, just a straight line with initial and final points which lie in the attractive basin of the product and of the reactant. And in principle, we would like to have a technique which brings ourselves along the ideal path, which is this black one shown here. So I told you already that the ideal path has to obey this equation, which means that along each point, the ideal path has zero gradient of the orthogonal force. And one can invent an algorithm. One can introduce a dynamics for each of these points, such, for example, a first-order dynamics that move the system in the direction of the orthogonal force. So if at a given moment, say at this moment of my iteration, my orthogonal force to the path is non-zero, if I move along that direction, I will reduce the orthogonal force, and so iteration by iteration, I will converge to the ideal path. This is a kind of steepest descent algorithm. This is a kind of steepest descent algorithm in which I replace the force just with its component orthogonal to the present iteration of the path. Now, one of the difficulties is that to compute just the orthogonal component of the force, I need to compute the tangent to the path and to subtract the projection of the force along the tangent. If my path is coarse-grained, the accuracy with which I can compute the tangent is quite low, actually, and this might bring to severe numerical instabilities. So this is known, has been known for a while. Perhaps you know of the Nudget elastic band method, in which you were still discretizing the path in images, and the way in which they were avoiding to compute the tangent is that they were connecting to successive images along the path with a spring, which essentially try to counterbalance the force that will move the bits toward the two minima. The lab itself, which has been quite successful since it has been introduced, it also suffers of some numerical instabilities, so one can try to do a bit better than that, which is the objective of the string method in collective variables. So we would like to replace this equation, which suffers of this potential problem of instability because of this orthogonal component of the force, with something which doesn't have it. And the key objective, the key point to achieve that objective is noticing that the real force acting on the coarse grain representation of my system at any of the points of the putative path at the given iteration, it consists of two components. So the actual force is the red one. There is one component that is actually orthogonal to the path. So it goes in the direction in which I want it to go, which is the orange one. And then there is a tangential component along the path, which the only effect will be to bring the point closer to themselves. While if I want to have a good description of my path, of course, I would like them to be uniformly spaced. So what one can imagine to do is to replace the single step approach in which I compute the force acting on the point and I replace and I remove the tangential component in a two-step process. In the first step, I move the system along the entire force. So if I do this, for example, this point will be moved here, in this point here. And if I do for all the points, of course, they will end up in the next step iteration, but they will be no longer at the same same distance with respect to each other. In particular, this will have the effect that the region around the transition state will be underpopulated, and so the accuracy with which I can compute the transition state will be quite low. But then I know what to do, because since I know that the tangential component of the force, the only effect it has, is to break the uniform distribution of the points, what I can do is that I can redistribute this point in order to make them at the same distance. And for example, I can do replacing the continuum ideal description of the fat with a polygonal curve, so the curve which just joined the points. I can compute the length of this polygonal path. I can divide the length in the same by the number of intervals, and I can put this point at a distance which is the same, which is the one of equispaced intervals. So without, by this approach, without having to compute any tangent or any orthogonal component of the force, I can still achieve the objective of having a good description of the reaction path without any numerical instabilities. Let me now show you a couple of examples in which actually a large number of collective variables has been necessary, and in which I and other colleagues used the string method in collective variables, showing its efficiency and importance. So here, the example I will give you is a bit more in my field. This concerns the wetting of textured surfaces. So here, in brown on the bottom, you see a surface, solid surface, which is not flat. It has a kind of square pillars on top of it. And in blue, you see a liquid put in contact with this textured surface. So perhaps against your intuition, if the solid is hydrophobic and the pillars, they have a proper width, height, and spacing, the liquid won't invade the cavities underneath, but will remain suspended over the top of the pillars. And what people is interested in is what is the relative stability of the state in which the liquid is suspended over the one in which the liquid enters into the cavities, and what is the rate, which means what is the barrier, for this wetting transition to take place. Now, people have studied these wetting transitions using collective variables, simple ones, like the number of particles of liquid into the cavities, which is an implicit and indirect measure of the amount of liquid in the cavities. And so by using standard techniques like umbrella sampling, they can compute the probability, the free energy, as a function of number of liquid particles into the texturation. Or collective variables, which are extension of this simple collective one. So if you wish, number of particles in this region is just the average density of liquid in this region. But you may want to use also a density field, so a local density. You can consider the space in the texturation here, and you can chop it into little boxes, and then you compute the number of particles boxes by boxes. If the array comes back, here we go. And you can use different kind of texturation. So for example, in the case of the surface in which we have 3x3 pillars, we can chop the space just in one region, like this, in 9 regions, essentially each one corresponding to a pillar, and then in 864 regions, in which you have plenty of boxes corresponding to each pillars in the horizontal or vertical directions. And you may compute the free energy in all these cases, and you see that the free energies, they have relatively different profiles. So for example, in the case of a single collective variables, you don't even have a well-defined maximum, and the free energy of the final state, the one in which you have a liquid completely wet in the cavities, is well above hundreds of KBT, so it's much higher than the one you compute with the other description of collective variables, which should not be the case. But you see something which is even more surprising. So what I'm showing here is the distance, Euclidean distance, computed in terms of proper observable, which I will avoid to describe here, along the reaction path, the wetting path, using 1, red line, 9, blue line, and 8064, green line, collective variables. Now, what you expect is that the distance in between successive images is almost all the same, all over the process. And indeed, with using roughly 900 collective variables, 8064, you get a uniform variation of collective variables from one image to the next. On the contrary, if you use less collective variables, you see this sudden change of distances in between successive images, which means that actually your system in this point, it has a big difference in configuration with respect to in between the previous and next configuration, which means that something important can happen in between and you are missing it. So you see that, for example, in this case, you are forced to use a high number of collective variables, 900. You cannot stick with what is available with standard approaches, 1 up to 9. So this means that also using single sweep won't be enough in this case. You need to use something different. And actually, we use the string method, and we were able to have an accurate description of the wetting path, which proceed with the liquid touching the bottom surface only one point, which was unknown before, and then spreading over the entire surface. But similar cases, you have also in problems more related to biological systems. So this is the case, for example, of the hydrophobic collapse of proteins. This is a work done around 10 years above by Eric van den Ende and David Chandler. And David Chandler had the idea, the intuition, that the collapse of hydrophobic proteins is not driven by internal degrees of freedom. It's not cannot be described in terms of dihedral angles, bond angles, and things like that. But rather, it is driven from fluctuations of the density of the water. So water gets rarefied, instantaneously rarefied around the protein, and this gives rooms to the protein to wrap. And only when this takes place, protein actually can wrap. So what they've done is that they have put a toy protein, this is just a set of Leonard Jones beads, into a water sample, and they discretize the simulation box in 130,000 collective variables, which means, once again, the density field corresponding to each of these cells. And of course, with 130,000 collective variables, there is no techniques, apart perhaps the string method, which allow you to compute whatever, neither the free energy loss K, but even not the reactive part. And actually, using the using this vectorial collective variable and the string method, they were able to reconstruct the wetting path and to identify that actually the transition state corresponds to the initial bending of the protein, so the one in which you have the first closure of the protein passing from the straight configuration, and this happened in correspondence of a reduction of the density near the protein. Only when this happened, then the protein can fold. And I don't report here the image, but they were able also to show that using these collective variables, you have a well-picked committer distribution around 0.5, which confirmed that such a complex collective variable actually is needed to describe the folding of hydrophobic protein in water. So this brings me to the conclusion of my seminar, which are the following. So I hope that you get convinced that also in simple processes or reactions, sometimes one or two collective variables, they are not sufficient. So you may need to use use an higher number of collective variables, which means a more complex space to explore.
there are techniques to validate whether your collective variables you had in mind were sufficient, which is through this committer analysis. But committer analysis tells you only if they are sufficient or not. Then you still might have to explore a larger space. Now, if your problem, if your subject, if the scientific problem you want to address is one of these cases in which you need a large number of collective variables, I'm proposing you two possible techniques to use. So if the number of collective variables is still limited, few of them, five, say, you might still want to reconstruct the entire free energy cascade that tells you a lot of things, gives you a lot of information. And in this case, you can use the single sweep method in which you separated the problem of exploring the space and the problem of reconstructing the free energy cascade. Or if you are working very high dimension, so tens, hundreds, thousands of collective variables, you may want to limit your attention to the reconstruction of the most probable reaction path and use the strict method, which scales linearly with the number of collective variables, so it's essentially affordable, has been used already for 100,000 collective variables, and it is numerically very stable, and so should be a guarantee to convergence in a reasonable time. And with this, I would like to thank the organizers for this opportunity once again, and for you for attending to this webinar. And I pass the word to Adam.
Thank you very much, Simone. So we have our first question in the question box already. I'd encourage anyone else who has any questions to ask them now. I don't know how many we'll have time for today, but if there's any that we don't get round to, we can always follow them up later. But so we do have our first question from Alberto Pietri. The question from Alberto is, the presenter showed us advantages of the single sweep approach, but which are the limitations or the disadvantages with respect to other approaches to reconstruct free energy landscapes, and are there cases where free energy landscapes make difficult or unsuitable to employ the single sweep method? So I think it's a question about the sort of the constraints and the conditions under which you can use these methods that you've described here.
Yeah. So one limitation, if you wish, is that other techniques, for example, metadynamics. They allows you to have an idea of the free energy while the trajectory goes. Already at intermediate stage, you can reconstruct the free energy at the present time. And for example, you can discover that already at that point you visited multiple minima with given relative free energy. Now, in principle, single sweep, the two-step approach, requires that you do also the second step, which is the reconstruction of the free energy. And you do the reconstruction to do the reconstruction of the free energy, you need to compute first the mean force, which means doing simulation on purpose for that. So this might be a limitation. However, if you do the exploration step in the way I was showing you before, if you evolve your system according to this equation under the conditions that there is a good time scale separation in between the physical atoms and the collective variables, actually the distribution of Z is also an estimate of the free energy. You need to rescale by the temperature, but it's something which is really simple. So also this limitation in principle can be waived. So maybe not a real limitation. What is a bit more tricky, and you cannot see by my equations here because I didn't report them in detail, is that in order to, that indeed underneath this minimization of the objective function, so this is essentially least square fitting. It's non-linear one if you introduce also sigma. If it is only for C, will be even a linear least square fitting. Now, underneath there is a coefficient matrix, and that can be ill-conditioned. If it is ill-conditioned, you might run in trouble for minimizing this objective function. And unfortunately, you don't know it beforehand. So you don't know this problem before doing your simulations. So this might be a limitation. And also, of course, a limitation which this approach shares with other techniques is that with the selected collected variables, you may have troubles in identifying well-defined metastable states. So you can still run short of the number of degrees of freedom you need to represent your system. And so you can just go more more far than the others, but this can be still insufficient.
Okay, hopefully that answers the question, Alberto. If you do have any follow-up. Okay, Alberto says thank you. So that's great. Any other questions from the floor? I'll ask one quick one just to give people an opportunity to type in if they have any more before we wrap up. So just a quick one more from the computational side. I was wondering whether these techniques that you've described here, whether they, I wondered how they scale compared to sort of more traditional techniques. Can you also use them on very large machines with many processors?
So we are using these techniques, for example, on Marconi, which is the Italian supercomputing machine, which is made of night landing processors. So low frequency, low energy, plenty of cores. And actually, the techniques I was showing you, they are optimal suited for this. So for what concerns the single sweep, the computationally expensive part is the calculation of mean force, this guy here. And you have to compute this mean force for each of the points of this summation. So for example, in the case of 25 points I was showing you before in this example here, we have to compute mean force at 25 values of the pair of collective variables. Now, these are 25 independent runs that you need to combine at the end. So in principle, you can combine the intrinsic parallelism of your molecular dynamics engine, classical or ab initio, with an embarrassing parallelism that comes from independence of calculations of the mean force in these points. And this, so you have a perfect, essentially a perfect scalability.
Yes.
And this is true as well for the string method. So let me come here. So you see that before we advance a string from this configuration to the next one, we need to compute the mean force at each of the images that are the discretization of the continuum path. Typically, we use in between 32 and 64 images. And before you do the final step of moving a configuration from here to there, configuration, I mean, in the coarse grain representation, these are completely independent calculations. So once again, you can exploit the embarrassing parallelism of independent calculation to do it.
Right.
We have been running this kind of calculation on any European machine of the present and the past. So for example, I'm actually running a CSCS. I have been running with some colleague years ago. It was, where was it? It was at the iCheck in Ireland. We have been running on different generations of Cinega machines. So I would say that they do well.
Great. Thank you very much. Okay, so I haven't had any more questions in the question box, so I think we will all wrap it up for today. Thank you very much indeed, Simone, for your presentation today, and thank you all for coming along to listen. A reminder that if you do have any other questions later, or if you just want to ask a question about any of the other things that BioXcel is working on, do check out our forums. You can find a link to them from the main BioXcel webpage. Okay, thank you all for coming along, and I'll hopefully see you all again soon. Bye.
Bye, thank you.